Good afternoon. My idea in the next talk is to take you in a trip to the mind of an oncologist nowadays with the availability of these new toys that we have today for research. So we're going to go deep into the mind of an oncologist in the new, this new area of precision medicine. So as you know, in cancer we are dealing with many different diseases. It's hard to say how many, 300, maybe more. Each of these tumor types may have different alterations in different genes. A combination of 5 to 10 different genes are going to be altered in cancer. But the problem comes when the structural alterations that we can see can vary in complexity, from point mutations to small structural changes in DNA, like in-frame or frame sheets alterations with small indels, to big chromosomal alterations like copy number alteration or gene fusions. So here you can see in different tumor types the number of genes that can be altered and that are playing a role in these tumors, but also we need to find out a difference between oncogenes, where normally mutations are focused only in one area of the gene. It's very hard to activate a gene or the product of a gene, so all the mutations fall into one region of the gene, while in tumor suppressor genes, making a protein non-functional is very easy, and many different alterations, many different mutations can happen all along the coding region of the gene. So when we are moving from in the historical view of how we treat cancer, we started looking at histology and treating cancers depending on the where the tumor was coming. Immunohistochemistry helped to subclassify these tumors, and we are entering the area of genomic medicine or genomic classification of tumors. But precision medicine is not coming out of the blue. It was in the context of the first treatments that work in specific tumor types like imatinib or trastuzumab. It was a big push in molecular biology in the 60s and 70s. But also it attracts a lot of attention, social attention to this area. Cancer is an important disease and is very relevant to society, as well as to pharma companies that started to develop many drugs and increase their pipeline, moving away from chemotherapies to more targeted therapies. So all this momentum really helped to develop more biomarkers that may be driving the tumor, but also more matching and more disease settings where a targeted therapy in a specific tumor type selected with a specific alteration using a biomarker granted a very significant anti-tumor activity, as you can see here. So all this momentum now encourages us to move to the next step in the area of precision medicine. So the FDA has developed some guidance to pharma companies to how to develop a drug for a specific tumor type and in a specific molecular context with the idea of companion diagnostic and developing the drug and the biomarker at the same time. Good news is that these kind of agents are normally better tolerated than chemotherapy, but this is a very general statement that needs some clarification. But we are seeing now nowadays when studying the molecular alterations in cancer is that one disease may be actually, for example, breast cancer, several diseases when we see at the molecular level, and we may be able to stratify to a very small molecular strata what we usually call one single disease. So to the point that there are two very different visions. One is to continue classifying diseases by tumor type and subclassifying them in molecular strata, or grouping some of them depending on the alteration. And we can see some similarities between breast cancer that are HER2 amplified with gastric cancer HER2 amplified. And you may be also familiar with the story of BRAF mutations in different tumor types, not only in melanoma. In parallel to this, we have seen a huge evolution in the toys that we can use, and the technology, biotechnology, and now we have very powerful like next generation sequencing platforms that we can work. So physicians nowadays, and here we have the brain of the physician, the oncologist, have this half of the brain focus on the treatment of patients with the biomarkers that we have now approved, with the drugs that we have now approved, with all these success stories that I have shown. But we have all these plethora of new biomarkers, these new drugs in development that are in research, but are also focused, gonna be working in specific molecular alterations. So we need now to match the drug with the biomarker, and we need to use the molecular biomarker tools more accurately. So this is why next generation sequencing seems a revolution to us, to oncologists, because we now are going to be able to perform this kind of analysis that we need and not go one by one. So just to make an example, let's say we talk about lung cancer. We used to classify the disease in different histologies, small cell lung cancer or squamous cell cancer, adenocarcinoma. We have learned that each of these tumors have different molecular alterations. And what we have learned is that when we use specific drugs for each one of the alterations, like EGFR mutations and an EGFR inhibitor, BRAF mutations and a BRAF inhibitor, RET inhibitor in RET translocated tumors, ALK inhibitor in ALK translocated, we can see tremendous efficacy of these targeted therapies. But the bottom line of this slide is that in one single disease, lung cancer, we are seeing all these different molecular alterations, structural alterations. We are seeing copy number alterations, like MET amplifications, we are seeing translocations, and we are seeing mutations. So we now, for deciding how to treat a lung cancer, we may need a tool, a biomarker strategy that really finds out if my patient has any of these alterations, because we have specific drugs for this. So when you see the different techniques that we have for molecular diagnosis, they have pros and cons of each of these techniques, but the one that can really find out all these alterations is next generation sequencing. This is why oncologists are feeling so excited about this new technology. We are now empowering oncologists to find out which patients can benefit from the drugs that are coming. But this is not as simple as we may see. We have seen an evolution in technology, but we have also, this has modified the paradigms that we are using. We used to have, in precision medicine, the development of one drug for one biomarker using one platform. This is the story of bemurafenib, a BRAF inhibitor, in BRAF mutants, detected by a kit and a platform developed by Roche, the COVA system. This is the one test, one drug paradigm. We quickly see, and we move through this line very quickly, because we saw some generation of platforms that were able to look at different molecular alterations, specifically mutations, in a multiplex fashion. And these technologies were quickly adapted and quickly outdated with the when next generation sequencing has become available to many research institutes. The question is, in this multi-categorical model where one single platform can look at different alterations, and this is normally mutations in oncogenes, those that were easy to find, and trying to match each alteration with a drug, now next generation sequencing can do the same thing, but what really is uneasing some of the researchers and oncologists, and we will see later in the presentation, is this huge amount of data that we also get using these powerful techniques. And this has the pros and cons of next generation sequencing that we will find. So we can do what we were doing in the past, quicker, maybe faster, maybe broader, but also we will get much more extra information that could be beneficial. From the clinical point of view in research, it is very important that the platform can be used for many different things. And the context of this research is going to be very important. It's going to be very important, the context of the subject. And it's not the same if we are sequencing a patient, a subject that is healthy, or if we are sequencing the tumor of a patient with advanced cancer. In the context of a healthy volunteer, it could be a patient, a subject in a family of hereditary cancer, or a member that we think is at risk, or the general patient of the general population. It's not the same sequencing germline in those different subjects. Obviously, it's not the same in a cancer patient that has received all kinds of therapy, and now we are looking for a specific, for a next drug that could be in the market, or if we are using this analysis just for prognosis and predictive markers. But also, it's important to know that in some of these analyses, we will need blood, germline, to compare tumor versus blood. There will be some findings in this analysis of germline that could eat and ease some of the community. Obviously, these platforms that we have seen in today and yesterday is very flexible and very, and we can use for analyzing alterations in DNA, but also in RNA, RNA expression. It has very different uses. So just by looking at mutations in DNA, we can also make some distinctions. And depending on the regions of interest, this could be like analyzing small regions of interest with a small panel, like the one that I'm showing in the slide. And this could be very quick, very fast, and very patient-oriented. In just a couple of days, we could have this result. It doesn't need a lot of bioinformatic analysis. So it could be quick and cheap to profile patients. If we go to capture approaches, we go deeper. The number of genes that we can analyze is broader, maybe the 400 genes that are related with cancer. But this will take more time, and it will be a little bit more expensive. Obviously, if we go to exome sequencing or to whole genome sequencing, this may take more efforts on the interpretation of the results. So where are we going to draw the line between clinical practice and research in the near future? I'm not sure. I think that as the knowledge becomes available and as these techniques become cheaper, the line where clinical practice starts and where research starts is going to be moving very quickly. We talk about context, and I think it's also very important how we use this analysis. We can have a tumor, we treat a patient, and we see what happened. So we can do a retrospective analysis of the molecular alterations in this tumor to try to understand what had already happened. This is a retrospective analysis, and this is how it all started, to see what happened, if we can explain based on the genomic alterations. This is where research is now focusing, is in trying to find which alterations the patient that I have in my clinic may have, in order to try to detect if a drug that is in development can be used in these patients. And in the near future, we may be using also these techniques for prognosis or subtyping of tumors. If we focus on selecting treatment, we need to make some decisions, and this is very important, I think. One is if we can use these techniques to find out if we can treat with drugs that are already in the market, like companion diagnostic tools, or if we are using them for clinical trial eligibility, so the analysis is part of a clinical trial, or these services, vendors that can provide this information to physicians in what is called lab-developed tests. So for a physician or an institution, there are two different strategies that now come into our mind. Should I open a genomic lab in my institution to be able to perform this kind of analysis in-house, or should I subcontract a vendor that does the job for me? There are some pros and cons, and we go to the extremes. Maybe local analysis could be a small set of genes that are very useful, we can customize for the need of the physician in that institution. The vendor may choose a broader large panel who serves many different interests, like tumor types or physicians. Local analysis may be quicker. It may save more tissue because we are looking for a small number of genes, and it will be maybe useful in formalin-fixed paraffin-embedded tissue, which is what we normally use. larger panels may find more false positives and maybe and quality control may be limiting. Obviously, if you have the lab already open and running, it's cheaper to do it locally, but you need to do the upfront investment in your lab and your platforms. For all clinical decisions, you need to certificate the lab. Normally, vendors already have their own lab certified, and this could be a lot of time consuming to put this in place. The analysis is going to be focused. The one with a larger panel would be broader, the analysis, more comprehensive, so this would be more collateral benefits. In one hand, you can customize if you do it in your own lab. With vendors, you have less potential to change and add genes of interest to the list of the ones that are analyzed. You may not need a germline. This is going to be a key issue. If you need to sequence both the tumor and the germline with a small panel, it may not be needed. And the bigger the panel, the more false positives that you may find if you don't sequence the germline. And the problem then comes also with the information, how to annotate each variant. So it's good for mutations if you have a small panel. It would be better with a large panel with a more regions, because you can then check also for copy number alterations and rearrangements. So let's focus on how can we use this. And normally, as we have said, in precision medicine, what we try to do is to find an alteration and allocate each patient to a different clinical trial. So those are the molecularly informed clinical trials. But it has many other benefits. For example, in this case, this is a breast cancer patient that the molecular analysis showed a mutation in epidermal growth factor. This is not frequent in breast cancer. The patient received an EGFR inhibitor, and there was a very good response in this patient. Here we see having more information makes things a little bit more complicated. In this patient, we found many different mutations. We picked the ones that are more known, mutations in PI3K. So we enrolled the patient in a clinical trial with a PI3K inhibitor, and it didn't work. The question was, should we have selected a BRAF inhibitor because we can see a BRAF mutation, or a MEK inhibitor because there is a KRAS mutation? We cannot combine so many drugs. So which is the driver of this tumor in this patient? What do we do if we don't have available drugs for alterations in P53 or SMAD4? Should we refer the patient to another institution? Those are the issues that the clinician may find, may need to deal when you have more information. This is another case, colon cancer. What caught our attention is a mutation in BRAF, but also the context where this mutation happens. It is in the context of many different other mutations, not only in genes that are considered relevant, but also many other mutations in other genes that were contained in the panel. So we suspect that this is a hypermutated tumor. And as we have seen in melanoma, and now we are seeing also in colon cancer, those tumors with hypermutations are more sensitive to immune therapies. So the patient actually was not referred to a BRAF inhibitor, but to a checkpoint inhibitor, an immune therapy therapy. That's why the context of a mutation and having more information to have more larger panels gives more information. Same thing can happen here, subclassifying the disease. In this case, it's a glioblastoma with a P10 mutation, so one could think that a PI3K inhibitor may work. Different patient, adenocarcinoma, from the gastric adenocarcinoma, but with a similar alteration, also a mutation in PI3K activating the same pathway. The recommendation would be the same, a PI3K inhibitor, but it also helps if we compare this patient with a cancer genome atlas, and we can begin to find that this glioblastoma can be classified as a classical glioblastoma. This gastric cancer patient could be Epstein-Barr virus, a patient with an infection with Epstein-Barr virus. So we can now start to also use this information to subclassifying the disease. And this has prognostic and predictive connotations. It's not only to drive patients to therapy, but also to begin to subclassify the disease, what we can get from this kind of analysis. Not everything is that easy. In this cancer patient, it's a breast cancer patient, and what it calls our attention is a mutation in a DNA repair. And this is in tumor, but in the report it says that these mutations could be linked to Lynch syndrome. If you are familiar with Lynch syndrome, this is normally hereditary cancer for colon cancer. It's not, no, it's not well related with breast cancer, so we are now beginning to suspect an hereditary cancer in a patient with breast cancer. That was not something that was an incidental finding, that we say. So the patient was referred to receive a treatment with a FGFR inhibitor because there is also an amplification here, but it was also referred to genetic counseling because if there is a Lynch syndrome in this patient, it may be running in the whole family and some patients may be at risk. So you can see now the collateral information that we get, and the American Association of Genetics has a number of mutations in genes that are related with hereditary cancer that need to be reported to the patient because it may have other implications to the family. So what are the issues? The issues, one of them is we need to do clinical trials in precision medicine, now we need clinical trials with the technology, with the biomarkers, and with the drugs. And this is not easy to set up. We have tried a pilot study in personalized medicine, each patient receiving a different therapy depending on the genomic context. And this makes things very complicated from the budgeting, from the what to know, to have in your pharmacies the drugs that you need for these patients. But if we don't change regulatory bodies and trial designs to be able to do these kind of things in clinical research, people will embrace the concept anyway. And maybe people reporting genomic cases, positive genomic cases in journals like these ones that have a section just for this, will be the excuse to use off-label drugs and not collecting then fundamental information of this matching of alterations and drugs. There are some web pages that are doing registries of cases of matching an alteration with a drug. So it would be either clinical research or the patient population who will give us big data on if precision medicine is really benefiting patients or not. The other key issue that I'm not sure we have covered in this meeting is that from the raw analysis of the sequencing to the reporting of physicians, there are many, many different filters and many decisions that are taken all along in the bioinformatics, the annotation, and the clinical interpretation. Here there is a work where the same data from the same patients, just using different bioinformatic filters, you can see the concordance was just 60%. So bioinformatic filtering, how we use this information and translate this to physicians, need still some work. So moving from the raw data to the reporting needs a lot of work. So to conclude, next-generation sequencing is in development. There are some biological issues that need to be covered, some regulatory things that are ongoing, and ethics. And this is work ongoing. Context matters, depending on the number of genes and the depth and the number of regions that we are analyzing, gets things more informative but also more complicated. And the final issue of should I develop my own lab or having somebody, a vendor doing this, depends really on your context. If you have a lot of patients and a lot of resources, you can do your own analysis. If not, you can rely on experts to do this for you. Thank you very much.